हेलो फ्रेंड्स, इन दिस सेशन वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट रिकेट्सिया। रिकेट्सिया आर ग्राम नेगेटिव बैसिलाई। दे आर ऑब्लिगेट इंटरसेलुलर पैरासाइट्स। रिकेट्सिया आर ऑब्लिगेट इंटरसेलुलर पैरासाइट्स। इन बैक्टेरियोलॉजी सेक्शन यू विल कम अक्रॉस दीज टू चैप्टर्स, वन इज़ रिकेट्सिया एंड वन इज़ क्लैमाइडिया। दे बोथ आर ऑब्लिगेट इंटरसेलुलर पैरासाइट्स, मीन्स दे कैनॉट सर्वाइव आउटसाइड अ होस्ट सेल। एंड हियर एट दिस पॉइंट वी कैन हैव एन अंडरस्टैंडिंग दैट देर आर सम बैक्टीरियाज विच आर एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर ओनली, देर आर सम बैक्टीरियाज विच आर इंटरसेलुलर एंड एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर बोथ, एंड देर आर सम बैक्टीरिया विच आर इंटरसेलुलर ओनली। तो इन एग्जाम्पल लाइक स्टेफेलोकोकस, स्ट्रेप्टोकोकस, वो सब एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर होते हैं, ठीक है। फिर देर आर सम बैक्टीरियाज लाइक माइकोबैक्टीरियम ट्यूबरकुलोसिस, नीजीरा मेनिनजाइटिडिस, नीजीरा गोनोरिया, स्टैल्मोनेला टाइफी एक्सेट्रा, विच कैन लिव इंटरसेलुलर एज वेल एज एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलर। देन देर आर सम बैक्टीरियाज लाइक रिकेट्सिया एंड क्लैमाइडिया, दे आर इंट्रासेलुलर ओनली, दे डोंट लिव एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलरली। तो दिस वी आर सपोज टू रिमेंबर। दे लिव एक्स्ट्रा सेलुलरली बट ओनली फॉर अ ब्रीफ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, बट लार्जली दे आर विद इन द सेल्स ओनली। रिकेट्सिया आर ग्राम नेगेटिव एरोबिक कोकोबैसिलाई, ऑब्लिगेट इंट्रासेलुलर पैरासाइट्स। दे आर नॉन मोटाइल, दे डू नॉट हैव फ्लैजिला। दे ऑल्दो दे आर ग्राम नेगेटिव बट दे ग्राम स्टेन इज़ नॉट अ सुटेबल स्टेन फॉर देम, सो द अदर स्टेन्स आर यूज, जिम्सा स्टेन इज यूज फॉर देम। एंड बिसाइड्स जिम्सा स्टेन देर आर थ्री अदर स्टेन्स, कस्टनिडा, मकाविलो एंड जिम्निस स्टेन्स, विच आर यूज फॉर रिकेट्सिया। एंड इवन फॉर क्लैमाइडिया दीज फोर स्टेन्स आर यूज, जिम्सा, कस्टनिडा, मकाविलो एंड जिम्निस। Obligate intracellular parasite means one which lives inside a host cell. Here as a prototype, in this figure you can see a WBC which has lots of particles in the cytoplasm. These particles are bacteria within the cytoplasm of the WBC. Now rickettsial cell infections, how do human beings acquire, and are there any agents which transmit rickettsial cell infection to human beings? So the answer for this question is that there are four types of arthropod vectors which transmit rickettsial infections to human beings. These four arthropod vectors are lice, fleas, ticks and mites. Lice, fleas, ticks and mites. These four arthropod vectors transmit rickettsial infections to human beings. Now, some rickettsial infections are found in human beings naturally, while some rickettsial infections are zoonotic infections which human beings acquire from other animals. Now, since rickettsia are obligate intercellular parasites, a question arises, are they able to survive outside a host? So rickettsia survive only briefly outside a human host, outside a cell, but there is one exception which is known as Coxiella burnetii. Coxiella burnetii was earlier grouped in rickettsia only, but since it has some features different from the regular rickettsial strains, this has been categorized as a separate bacterium. And Coxiella burnetii can survive outside a host cell, and it is quite rough and tough, resistant to desiccation, heat, sunlight, and it is transmitted primarily by airborne route, while rickettsia are transmitted by the vectors. Are rickettsia cultivable? Can we grow rickettsia? They can be grown in any cells. So we can use yolk sac of chick embryo, we can use cell lines like HeLa cells, Hep2 cells, Detroit 6, mouse fibroblast, etc. We can use experimental animals like guinea pig and mice. So yolk sac, cell lines and experimental animals, these three can be used for growing rickettsia. Now the classification of rickettsia shows there are three genera, genus Rickettsia, the family Rickettsia. There are three genera, genus Rickettsia, genus Oriensia and genus Ehrlichia. The genus Rickettsia has organisms causing two types of diseases. One is typhus fever group and one is spotted fever group. In typhus fever group, there are three conditions: epidemic typhus, Brill's incer disease, and endemic typhus. While in spotted fever group, there are some diseases like Rocky Mountain spotted fever and rickettsial pox, etc. The typhus fever group divided into three categories: epidemic typhus caused by Rickettsia provaseae, Brill's incer disease also caused by Rickettsia provaseae, it is a reactivation of epidemic typhus. Then the third one is endemic typhus, which is caused by Rickettsia typhi. Then the second genus is genus Orientia, which causes scrub typhus. This scrub typhus is also known as Shigerborne typhus, and it is caused by the bacterium Orientia shushugamushi. Then genus Ehrlichia is there. Genus Ehrlichia causes ehrlichiosis, and they infect the WBCs of the host. There are several species: Ehrlichia senetsu, Ehrlichia sephensis, Ehrlichia equi, etc. So this was the classification of Rickettsia, in which it is divided into three genera, and there are several pathogens of different diseases in these three genera. Now this is one table which shows different diseases caused by rickettsial bacteria, the causative organisms, the geographical distribution, the arthropod vectors involved, the vertebrate host, rash distribution, and eschar formation. In several rickettsial diseases, there is rash formation in the body, and in some of them even eschar formation is there. Eschar means a black color lesion which is formed in certain disease conditions. The spotted fever group and the typhus fever group, these two groups and rickettsial diseases, each disease has its a particular organism which is the causative agent, and some particular geographical distribution, and arthropod vectors are there in rickettsial diseases, except one condition where you can see that there is no arthropod vector mentioned, that is Brill's incer disease, but that is just a reactivation of epidemic typhus, so no vector is written down here, right? And so these all features of different conditions. As we come across the conditions, we will go through the features. Now what is the pathogenesis of rickettsial diseases? When a vector acquires the bacteria, it grows within the body of the vector, whether it is lice, fleas, ticks or mites. It will grow in the alimentary canal of the vector after blood meal from the infected man. Generally, the vectors acquire rickettsia when they go for a blood meal, and once it reaches the alimentary canal of the vector, it will start multiplying there. And in some cases, the rickettsia may be shed in the feces of the vector. In some cases, it will be in the proboscis, means in the it will be released in the saliva, or in some cases it might be present only in the blood. And when the insect dies and its blood is coming in contact with the skin, then the person can acquire. So there are different methods of by which person can acquire rickettsial infection from the vector, that we will see further. How are they transmitted from the vector to human host? So the infected arthropod vector can transmit to man either through their bite, or when the insect feces is rubbed on the surface of the skin, or when such insect is crushed into abraded skin at the site of bite. So not all rickettsial infections are transmitted by bite of the vector, but several will also be transmitted by feces or rubbing of the organism vector on the skin, leading to exposure of the skin to the bacteria present within the body of the vector. Now once the bacteria enters the human host, what happens? Is there any local lesion at the site where there was a bite, or where the organism was crushed, or the feces was rubbed? Are there any local lesions, and does it spread in the body? Are the lymphatics involved? So at the site of entry, They multiply in the endothelial cells of the microvessels close to the inoculation site, and there is a dark swollen crusted lesion known as eschar formation. And initially for a week or so, the bacteria will multiply locally and they will lead to local hypersensitivity reaction. From there they will spread to the lymphatics, and regional lymphadenopathy will occur, and from there further via the lymphatics they will go to the bloodstream and spread in the entire body. What is the target site of rickettsia and what are the effects? The target sites, the rickettsia, they travel in the macrophages in the bloodstream and they reach the endothelium of various blood vessels throughout the body. So the endothelial cells of small blood vessels of the skin and different organs are the target site, and they will multiply into endothelial cells, and it will lead to vasculitis and perivascular mononuclear cell infiltration. Inside these endothelial cells, the rickettsia will survive. They will multiply, leading to vasculitis and other complications. Where exactly in these endothelial cells do the rickettsia live? So they can live within the cytoplasm or within the nucleus of the infected cell, and they will multiply by binary fission like other bacterias. At this junction, I just remember one point that earlier rickettsia were, since they are very small in size, they are believed to be viruses by some people, but later on it was found that rickettsia, they are bacteria, because they had all the features of bacteria. They had RNA and DNA both, they had a gram negative cell wall, and several other features which put them in the category of bacteria. So one thing different from bacteria is that they are obligate intercellular organisms like viruses, and they are very small in size. So such features were making them close to viruses, but later on they were confirmed to be bacteria. We move ahead. What are the effects of rickettsia on the blood vessels? The rickettsia, they infect the endothelial cells of the blood vessels, leading to vasculitis, infiltration. It can lead to thrombus formation, and this thrombus formation can lead to occlusion of blood supply to various tissues of the body. It can lead to purpuric skin rashes, and it can lead to bleeding. The clotting system can be activated. Disseminated intravascular coagulation can take place. It can lead to cardiac failure and death finally. So it can be dangerous if untreated. Now we have a look at the first group, that is typhus fever group. Typhus fever group has three conditions: epidemic typhus, Brill-Jenzer disease, and endemic typhus. The epidemic typhus is caused by Rickettsia provaseki. Now in the name Rickettsia provaseki, Rickettsia is also a name derived from the name of the scientist Howard Taylor Ricketts, and provaseki is also a name derived from the name of a scientist, Provasek. Okay, Rickettsia provaseki, the causative agent of epidemic typhus. Epidemic typhus is also known as louse-borne typhus, and it has some other names like gaul fever and classical typhus. So here in this page itself you can see four names of the same condition: epidemic typhus, louse-borne typhus, gaul fever and classical typhus. Kaun transmit karta hai? To louse-borne typhus fever or epidemic typhus is transmitted by the human body louse, Pediculus humanus corporis. The Pediculus humanus corporis is the common louse found on the human body, and it is present on different parts of the body. This is the body louse. Alright. Then there is another louse called head louse, which is different from this. But remember, human body louse, Pediculus humanus corporis, is the transmitting agent for Rickettsia provaseki. How will the person acquire infection from the human body louse? Will infect a person with existing typhus fever, and from there it can catch hold of the organism and transfer it to another host, a new host, who can acquire the infection from that. This is the human body, Laus pediculus humanus corporis. The louse feed on the infected rickettsemic person, and once the louse feeds, the bacteria goes in its alimentary canal, and it will start shedding the bacteria in large numbers in feces in about a week's time. Kaise transmit karta hai? So when the louse takes a blood meal, it defecates, and the irritation causes the host to scratch the site, and as the host scratches the site, the louse feces will contaminate the bite wound, and through that bite wound the bacteria will enter the host. After the louse has bitten the host, it dies of the infection in 1 to 3 weeks and does not transmit the infection to its offspring. And in the human host, which people are more susceptible? People who are in crowded areas where there is no proper hygiene, they are more at risk, and in winter conditions the disease occurs more, and during war or natural disasters it has been observed that it has led to epidemics during wars and natural disasters. Itihas gawah hai. There are many records of this epidemic typhus or louse-borne typhus in the history, like in Russian Revolution, then in various devastating epidemics have occurred in wars and famines in the past, and even Napoleon's retreat was because of this epidemic typhus. His army got infected by this epidemic typhus, because of which Napoleon had to go back from the war front. Fear in the Russian Revolution, Lenin told that it was such a big problem at that time that Lenin told that either socialism will defeat the Laos or the Laos will defeat socialism. In India, Kashmir, this disease is found in. What are the clinical features? After an incubation period of about 1 week's duration, there will be headache, fever, chills, myalgia. There is no eschar formation in epidemic typhus. Incubation period is about 1 to 2 weeks, and there will be fever, chills and rash. By second week there can be stupor and delirium. And how does typhus fever get its name? So typhus means cloud. So cloudy state of consciousness, mental clouding hota hai, uski wajah se uska naam pada typhus fever. And one important point to be remembered here is that the rash in typhus fever, I mean epidemic typhus, the rash is involving the entire body, but it spares the face, palms and soles. So this is a characteristic feature of this rash, which helps in identifying. It spares the face, palms and soles. Louse-borne typhus fever can lead to various rashes on the body. The human body, Laus pediculus humanus corporis. Nidan means diagnosis. For diagnosis of epidemic typhus or louse-borne typhus, Weil-Felix reaction can be used. What is Weil-Felix reaction? We will see further in the chapter. It is a heterophil agglutination test in which rickettsia and proteus mein kuch antigens ka sharing hota hai. So for diagnosis of several rickettsial conditions, these antigens are taken from proteus, and this antigen from the proteus are mixed with the patient's serum. If there is clumping, then it indicates the patient has rickettsial infection. So this heterophil agglutination test, known as Weil-Felix test, is used for diagnosis of several rickettsial conditions. Besides Weil-Felix test, polymerase chain reaction can be used. Then there are several non-rickettsial infections which can mimic the louse-borne typhus, like measles, typhoid fever, meningococcemia, bacterial meningitis, secondary syphilis, infectious mononucleosis, rubella, etc. Nivaran. Nivaran means prevention. How to control the situation? The control of the human body louse by hygiene, cleanliness and hygiene. Then vaccine is also available, typhus vaccine. And besides the vaccine, delousing process can be done, removal of the human body louse. The typhus vaccine is prepared from formaldehyde inactivated Rickettsia provaxiae grown in embryonated eggs. किसके लिए टीका अनुशंसित है? Means, what are the indications of the vaccination? Which population needs to be given the vaccine? The special risk group of populations are there which required the typhus vaccine. It is not required to be given to the entire population, but those people who are at risk of acquiring epidemic typhus, they need to be given vaccination. The first is scientific investigators, the archaeologist or anthropologist, construction workers, other people who are working in such areas where this infection occurs. Then medical personnel who provide care to such patients, and laboratory person who handle Rickettsia provaxiae. All these people are at risk of acquiring infection and they need to be given vaccines. What is Brill-Zinsser disease? Brill-Zinsser disease is a reactivation of epidemic typhus. After epidemic typhus has subsided by treatment, after several months or several years, there can be a reactivation of the same condition. That is known as recrudescence of the same condition, and it is known as Brill-Zinsser disease. The illness is similar to Lousborne typhus, but it is generally milder and more closely resembles the murine typhus or endemic typhus. Now, serologically, Welfelix reaction is usually negative, but a low titer to OX19 may be present. And how do we differentiate this recrudescence, that is Brill-Zinsser disease, from epidemic and endemic typhus? Then epidemic and endemic typhus both are fresh conditions, so IgM formation will take place in both these conditions. But Brill-Zinsser disease is a recrudescence, so Brill-Zinsser mein IgG hoga, IgM nahi hoga. So serological test se agar hum ye detect kar le, then we can differentiate Brill-Zinsser disease from epidemic typhus and endemic typhus. Therapy is same as for primary Lousborne typhus. Next is Rickettsia typhi. Rickettsia typhi is the causative agent of murine typhus or flea-borne typhus or endemic typhus. Now here the same condition has three names. It is known as endemic typhus. It is present endemically in several areas. It does not lead to epidemics. It is endemic typhus. And it is also known as flea-borne typhus based on the vector, that is fleas are the vector of this condition. It is also known as murine typhus. And the causative agent is Rickettsia typhi. Biodata. Rickettsia typhi causes murine typhus or flea-borne typhus. And the reservoirs are rats, cats and opossums. The vectors are fleas. It is present all over the world. Rickettsia typhi is also known as Rickettsia Moseri. And a normal host are the rats. And the vector is rat flea Xenopsyla chopis. It is shed in the faces of the vector. Kaise hota hai? The humans acquire infection by bite when the feces or saliva are rubbed on the skin, or through aerosols of dried feces. Here just note down that in case of endemic typhus, bite se bhi transmit hota hai, ya feces or saliva rubbed on the skin or through aerosols of the dried feces, yani ki multiple routes se wo acquire kar sakta hai. As for epidemic typhus, usme aisa tha ki when the organism was crushed in the bite wound, तो फिर वहाँ से पर्सन एक्वायर करता था. वहाँ पे बाइट से एक्वायर नहीं होता था, वो क्रशिंग ऑफ द ऑर्गेनिज्म से होता था. और यहाँ पे मल्टीपल रूट्स हैं, बाइट भी है, फीसेस और सलाइवा रब्ड ऑन द स्किन और थ्रू एरोसोल्स ऑफ द ड्राइड फीसेस. दिस डिजीज डज नॉट स्प्रेड फ्रॉम मैन टू मैन. इट इन इंडिया इट इज़ फाउंड इन कश्मीर. फ़र्क क्या है? तो Rickettsia typhi और Rickettsia provaxiae में डिफरेंस एक नील मुजर रिएक्शन करके होता है, उसको ट्यूनिका रिएक्शन भी बोलते हैं. तो नील मुजर रिएक्शन इज़ यूज टू डिफ्रेंशिएट बोथ दिस पैथोजेंस, Rickettsia typhi एंड Rickettsia provaxiae. इन नील मुजर रिएक्शन मेल गिनीपिग्स में इंट्रापेरिटोनियली इनोकुलेट करते हैं, उसकी वजह से स्क्रोटल स्वेलिंग हो जाता है और टेस्टिस इज नॉट रिट्रैक्टेबल इन द एब्डोमेन. एंड दिस रिएक्शन इज पॉजिटिव इन Rickettsia typhi, while it is negative in Rickettsia provazeki. So this Neil-Muser reaction in male guinea pigs is used for differentiating Rickettsia typhi and Rickettsia provazeki. Rickettsia typhi, the causative agent of endemic typhus or flea-borne typhus or murine typhus, and Rickettsia provazeki, the causative agent of epidemic typhus. Rat flea Xenophthalo chopis is the vector of flea-borne typhus or endemic typhus. Diagnosis of this condition, clinical suspicion, then culture can be done in cell lines or York sac or experimental animals. This Tunica reaction or Neil-Muser reaction can be done. Polymerase chain reaction can be done. Immunohistological demonstration can be done. Here you can remember one formula for this condition, 4M, where Rickettsia typhi is also known as Rickettsia Museri. So from that, 1M comes from there. Second M comes from murine typhus. It is also known as murine typhus. So then third M comes from endemic typhus. It is also known as endemic typhus. And the fourth M comes from Neil-Muser reaction. So a 4M formula can be used to remember some features of endemic typhus. The spotted fever group is the next condition, and after spotted fever group, some other organisms will also be studied in this group, but this shall be in the second portion. Thank you.